This is what we call a topical sermon. So I'm just drawing an idea out of our text, and really it's only to continue what it is we were looking at this morning with regard to the covenant. And I really thought that reading this chapter would fill that out a little bit. I mean, how can we, in the course of, well, an hour basically, fill out everything that the Lord has given to us through the covenant, through this work, through His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, because of what Jesus has done? There's really no way we can. All we can do is maybe touch on just a few of them. But the thing I really want us to focus on is the fact that God is in earnest. He is sincere. These things are ours. And again, not because of us, but because of Jesus. It all hinges upon Him and His work. So that's what we really want to focus on. But as I read this, I just want us to see a portion of what it is that the Lord has really given to us in the Lord Jesus. So this is what we read, and obviously we're going to see things that the Lord calls us to do on the basis of this covenant as well. Paul writes to the Philippians, "Therefore, my beloved brethren, whom I long to see, my joy and my crown, in this way stand firm in the Lord, my beloved. I urge Euodia and I urge Syntyche to live in harmony in the Lord. Indeed, true companion, I ask you also to help these women who have shared my struggle in the cause of the gospel, together with Clement also, and the rest of my fellow workers whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your gentle spirit be known to all men. The Lord is near. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all comprehension, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is of good repute, if there is any excellence, and if anything worthy of praise, dwell on these things. The things you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. But I rejoice in the Lord greatly that now at last you have revived your concern for me. Indeed, you were concerned before, but you lacked opportunity. Not that I speak from want, for I have learned to be content in whatever circumstances I am. I know how to get along with humble means, and I know also how to live in prosperity. In any and every circumstance, I have learned the secret of being filled and going hungry, both of having abundance and suffering need. I can do all things through Him who strengthens me. Nevertheless, you have done well to share with me in my affliction. You yourselves also know, Philippians, that at the first preaching of the gospel after I left Macedonia, no church shared with me in the matter of giving and receiving, but you alone. For even in Thessalonica, you sent a gift more than once for my needs. Not that I seek the gift itself, but I seek for the profit which increases to your account. But I have received everything in full and have an abundance. I am amply supplied, having received from Epaphroditus what you have sent, a fragrant aroma, an acceptable sacrifice, well-pleasing to God. And my God will supply all your needs according to His riches and glory in Christ Jesus. Now to our God and Father be the glory forever and ever. Amen." Actually, that one verse summarizes everything that we really need to see this evening. The Lord will provide for all of our needs, whatever they may be, to make sure we get from here to there, to make sure we do arrive there, and to make sure that we have what we need to be able to love and serve Him while we are in this world. He will provide all of it through the Lord Jesus. And that's, of course, what we want to be confirmed in this evening. That's what we want to see again and to know why God will provide these things for us. So let's again just reflect a bit on what we saw this morning, and let's think about again what Jesus has done for us, in this new covenant. Now this morning, again, I think I've already reminded you, we saw the psalmist crying out to God at a very dark time in Israel's history. The temple in Psalm 74, as he explains it, the temple had been burned to the ground. Everything inside of it had been smashed to pieces. The meeting places of God throughout the land were all destroyed, and the prophets were gone. Judah was in captivity, and nobody knew how long this was going to continue. In the middle of this situation, the psalmist looks to the Lord, to the one who had shown his mercy in the past to Israel, to the one who had entered into a covenant with them. And remember, a covenant is a legal contract. God had promised to do certain things for them, and he required certain things of them, and of course there were blessings and there were curses that were connected to that, and the curse had fallen upon them, but the psalmist was asking for mercy, asking for God's mercy. He, as I said, made this covenant with them, and Abraham, he had given himself to them as their God. I shall be your God. And he had taken them to be his people. You shall be my people. It was on the basis of this covenant that the Lord had delivered them out of the land of Egypt. Remember, we saw the symbolic language he used in the psalm, that he divided the waters. He crushed the head of the serpent and Leviathan, the sea monsters in the water, referring to Egypt. God had brought his people through, and he had destroyed their enemies in the waters. He brought them out of the iron furnace, out of slavery in Egypt, a picture of the bondage of sin. And he cared for them and brought them ultimately into the land of their inheritance. Again, a picture of what the Lord does for us. Now, he called upon the Lord to remember his covenant, to call it again to his mind, to have regard for it. Actually, the Lord was having regard for it. He was bringing the curses that he threatened upon them. But the psalmist was referring to the other part, the mercies and the blessings, to asking God basically to arouse himself and to act on behalf of his people because he is a gracious God. One who shows mercy to all who call upon him, who call upon him in truth. Now, we noted as well that this is something that we can do because we also are in covenant with God through his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. As a matter of fact, we can expect even more from the Lord, and even more that he is disposed to hear us and to answer us, because the covenant that he has made with us is a much better covenant. That's essentially what the whole book of Hebrews is about, is to show us the superiority of the new covenant over the old covenant or the Mosaic covenant. Moses, as we know in the old covenant, had brought them out of Egypt and brought them to the border of the land, but he wasn't able to bring them in because of their sin. They had to wander for 40 years in the wilderness because of that sin until the whole generation that didn't trust the Lord died off. Once they conquered and possessed the land, we see in Psalm 74, which is talking about the Babylonian exile, that they weren't able to hold on to the land because they weren't able to keep the covenant. They did not continue in my ways, the Lord says, and I did not care for them, which is why the Lord removed them from the land. The old covenant, in the old covenant, the law was written on stone tablets, and it didn't give them the power to obey God. It could only condemn them because they could only look at the commandments and realize they could not keep them. It's only when these commandments are written by the finger of God's Spirit upon the fleshly tablets of our hearts that we can. And this is what Jesus has provided in the new covenant. Because of the new covenant, we will enter into heaven. We will enter into the reality that the land that they had for a time only pictured, because Jesus guarantees it through his perfect life, through his atoning death. Because he rose again and ascended into heaven that he might send his Spirit into the world to conquer us, to subdue us, to change our hearts, so that we might love him and trust in him, that we might become the heirs of his kingdom by coming into covenant with him. He has redeemed us from the world as he redeemed them out of Egypt. He will care for us in this world in the way that he cared for them in the wilderness after he brought them out of Egypt. And he will bring us into heaven as he brought them into the land of promise. Only once we arrive there, we'll never be exiled or cast out of heaven as they were out of the land, because our inheritance is not based upon our works. It's based upon the work that Jesus did. Now this evening I want us to consider what we can expect our Lord to do for us because of this covenant as we make our way through this world, through the wilderness, on our way to home in heaven. We do want to see that he will provide. The Lord will provide everything we need. But, like the psalmist, we have to look to him. We have to look to his promises in the Lord Jesus. We have to trust him. We have to ask him to remember his covenant. Now, I know that sounds strange. So we need to remember, before we begin to look at this, what we mean by the fact that we need to ask God to remember his covenant. Because God hasn't forgotten. He hasn't forgotten his promises. We'll see why he hasn't forgotten his promises. We don't need to remind God to be gracious to us. He is far more aware of his promises and of his desire to be gracious toward us, and is much more intent on giving us these things than we are even in asking him. We do need to understand, when we're asking God to remember the covenant, we're really asking ourselves, or reminding ourselves, that he has made these promises to us, and we are looking to him to fulfill him. That's one thing we're doing. The other thing is that there are times when God does withdraw for a period of time, such as when he brings trials, or when we fall into sin, and he hides his face of blessing, as he did in the case of Israel, and when he took them into exile because of their sins. And when that happens, we do need to look to the Lord again and ask him to remember the covenant he has made with us, the one he has made with his Son and with us in his Son through the Lord Jesus Christ, and ask him to again show his mercy, show his grace because of what he has done for the Lord Jesus Christ, through the Lord Jesus Christ, in the Lord Jesus Christ, to ask him on the basis of this covenant, of this agreement, of this contract that he has entered into with us through Jesus, because it is the guarantee that he will provide for us. Now, what I'd like us to do is look at basically three things that all have to do with Jesus to remind us why God must give what it is he has promised to us in the covenant. And it really all revolves around Jesus Christ. First of all, we need to believe the Lord will do what he has promised for us because of the vicarious nature of Jesus' work. Basically, we want to look at three things. The vicarious nature of his work, which means that he took our place. We're going to want to look at it from the basis of the fact that God, for that work, has made certain promises to Jesus, and those promises are the basis of what Jesus gives to us. And then thirdly, because of our union with Jesus in the Lord Jesus Christ, we actually deserve these promises. But again, it's only because of Jesus and his righteousness. So first of all, we need to believe that God will do what he has promised to do for us in his covenant because the work that Jesus did, he did in our place. Now, I thought it was kind of interesting, as we were thinking about the Mosaic Covenant this morning, we saw that in a certain sense, the history of Israel and this covenant that God made with Israel was like a grand picture of the work that Jesus Christ was actually coming to do. Remember that God sent Moses into Egypt in order to bring his people out, and Moses is a great type of the Lord Jesus Christ. As a matter of fact, the author to the Hebrews reminds us that Moses did not really consider the reproach of being Christ or of Christ anything to stop him from doing what the Lord had called him to do. And it wasn't that Moses had Jesus in his eyes directly, But what it was referring to was the fact that he was the Christ. He was the Messiah. He was the picture of Jesus. He was the one God sent into Egypt to bring his people out. So Moses is a picture of Jesus. The whole Mosaic covenant is a grand picture of the work of Jesus Christ. The priesthood that he ordained is a picture of the priesthood of Jesus, the one who offers sacrifice and who prays on behalf of his people. We actually saw the prophet, the office of prophet, is a picture of Jesus, the one who declares to us the will of God for our salvation, and the office of king, the one who subdues us to himself as he does by his grace, and the one who conquers his and our enemies. All of that was a part of the Mosaic covenant. The sacrifices, obviously, were a picture of Jesus, and the law, which was showing us the standard that we couldn't meet, and showing us that we needed somebody to meet it for us. And that's exactly what Jesus did. And in doing so, as we know, gives us by his Spirit the ability to do it. Even Israel's being brought into Egypt in the first place, which was through the famine and so forth, God provided for his people in Israel, and then delivering them out of Egypt, that too was a picture of Jesus. I don't think we often think about that. But looking back at the Exodus, the Lord said through Hosea the prophet in Hosea 11:1, when Israel was a youth, I loved him, and out of Egypt I called my son. Sometimes God views Israel, the whole nation, as one person. And through the lens, as it were, of the covenant, he views them all as that which he loves. And as you know, the people he brought out of Egypt weren't exactly that lovable, and most of them died in the wilderness, which means most of them did not even trust in the Lord. But this is how the Lord viewed them. And one of the reasons is because they were a picture of his son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Why was it that when Herod went to kill all the children, that Joseph took him into Egypt? We read in Matthew 2, verses 14 and 15, so Joseph got up and took the child and his mother while it was still night and left for Egypt. He remained there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet, out of Egypt I called my son. Jesus went into Egypt and was brought out of Egypt because he was essentially reliving Israel's history, recapitulating, reenacting it, only this time he was doing it the way that it needed to be done to fulfill history, to fulfill righteousness. But let's not forget, too, that what Jesus did, I should say that the whole Exodus event was a picture of the coming work of Jesus' redemption. Jesus did what he did not just to reenact Israel's history and do it right, but he did these things because he was doing them for us. He was taking our place. He lived the life we were called to live in our place. He took our place. He died in our place. He rose again in our place. He ascended into heaven in our place so that he might eventually bring us there. Think of it in these terms, as we looked at this morning. Egypt is a type of the world. When God calls his son out of Egypt, when he calls Israel out of Egypt, he's redeeming them out of the world, and he's bringing them to the promised land. Well, Jesus comes into the world. He comes into Egypt that he might redeem us out of Egypt, that he might bring us out of the world, and that he might bring us to the promised land. Now, the fact that Jesus did this for us is why we will receive the promises. Jesus is the one who personally guarantees the blessings of the covenant to us. That's what we were talking about this morning when we said Jesus is our surety. He is our cosigner. He is our guarantee the conditions of the covenant will be met so that we will receive the blessings. But we receive them because of him. He's the one who did the work. He's the one who earned the prize. He is the one who then freely gives it to us. They are certain to us. All the promises of God are yes and amen through the Lord Jesus because of what he has done. So first of all, these things are ours because Jesus did what needed to be done for us. Now secondly, we need to believe that God's going to give us these promises because of the promise of the Father has made to the Son. The promise of rewards for his work. He will not deny his Son, but he will give him everything that he said. Now again, this morning we thought for a few moments on that eternal arrangements between the three persons of the Godhead. How the Father eternally purposed to send his Son. Remember, the Father created. The Father knew, well, he was going to allow the fall. He didn't force Adam to sin, but he knew Adam was going to sin. That was a part of his plan. But he also knew what he was going to do to glorify himself through that fall in the work of redemption. And his work, of course, was to choose a people, but it was also to send his Son into the world. The Son eternally purposed that he would come into the world as a man and do what was necessary to save us, as we just saw. And the Spirit eternally purposed to apply what Jesus did to his people, to apply Christ to them, and to change them by working from the inside out so that they might become like him. Now, this was the plan. But there was also a reward for this work, a reward that was going to go really to all three, but particularly to the Son. The Son was going to be honored for the work that he did. And we read about that reward in Isaiah 53, verses 10 through 12. The Lord's, Isaiah says to the inspiration of the Spirit, "But the Lord was pleased to crush him, putting him to grief. If he would render himself as a guilt offering, he will see his offspring. He will prolong his days, and the good pleasure of the Lord will prosper in his hand. As a result of the anguish of his soul, he will see it and be satisfied. By his knowledge, the righteous one, my servant, will justify the many, as he will bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will allot him a portion with the great, and he will divide the booty with the strong, because he poured out himself to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he himself bore the sin of many and interceded for the transgressors." What we have here, of course, is the work of our Lord Jesus, what he came into the world to do. And this was, again, several centuries before he came into the world. But he would receive a reward for this work, and that reward was made up of two things, essentially. He would receive a people. He would receive us. And he would receive a kingdom, his portion with the great. The Lord would save a people that he would give to his Son, and he would preserve them for his Son. In the vision that he records in the book of Revelation, John tells us that the 24 elders before the throne of God sang a new song when the Lamb was introduced to open up the scroll and to remove its seals. We read in Revelation 5, verse 9, "Worthy are you to take the book and to break its seals, for you were slain and purchased for God with your blood men from every tribe and tongue and people and nation." These are the ones Jesus receives as a reward for his work. Now, the Father also promised to subdue all of the Son's enemies. He subdues some of them by conquering their hearts, as we have already reminded ourselves from this morning. He comes in by his Spirit, opens our eyes, shows us the beauty of the Savior, and draws us out to him. But those who aren't subdued in that way are subdued in another way, which is not as pleasant as the way in which he subdues us. We read in Psalm 110, verse 1, "The Lord says to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet." And then Paul reminds us of the same thing in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 25. He says, "For he," that is Jesus, "must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet." Now let's not forget that the enemies of the Lord are also our enemies. And even as the psalmist this morning, we saw him crying out against the enemies of the Lord because of what they had done to his people. Those that would harm us, the Lord is also subduing. Doesn't mean we're going to go through this life unscathed, of course, but it does mean that he has overcome them, and they cannot do anything to us that God has not planned for our good. But I want you to notice the promises that the Father has made to His Son, a people and a kingdom, a people for His own possession, the protection of those people, the subjection of His enemies, really all the blessings of the covenant that we receive from the Lord Jesus Christ really come from these two promises that the Father has made to His Son. We are blessed because the Father has determined to bless His Son. And you know, if the Father is promised that He's going to do this for the Son, He is going to do it for the Son. And that becomes the basis of what the Son does for us. So we will receive the blessings of the covenant, all of them. When we call upon the Lord and we trust Him to give us these things, He will give them to us because He made a promise to His Son. So Jesus stands in our place to earn the blessings. The Father promises to give Him these blessings because He was willing to do this. And these are the things that He has promised to us in the covenant. Now finally, we will receive them because of our union with the Son. And the union with Christ is really a broad, huge subject, so I'm just going to touch on it. When the Spirit of God united us to Jesus, several things happened. The life of Jesus began to flow through us. We were dead, but He made us alive. You know, we came into the world dead in trespass and sin, hating God, but when the Spirit unites us to Jesus Christ and His life flows through us and we are quickened again to life, we can see, we can hear, we see the beauty of our Lord Jesus. Our heart turns, as it were, from a heart of stone to a heart of flesh and begins to beat for Him. Everything then that Jesus has done becomes ours. We have His righteousness. Our sins are all taken away. The atonement is basically applied to us. All of this comes through union with the Lord Jesus Christ, but one other thing comes through that union, which has to do with this. The fact that we are in Him, that's what union with Jesus, when we talk about being in Christ, we are in union with Him. We have this vital living union, His life flows through us. We have this legal union, which means that what He has legally earned becomes ours and so forth. But there is also this identification between us and the Lord Jesus Christ, which means, again, that what Jesus has done, we have done, and what He receives, we receive. He obeyed, and we obeyed in Him. He died, and you know the Scripture says, when He died, we died with Him. We went down into the grave with Him. When He rose, we rose with Him, and when He ascended, we ascended with Him. What He receives, we receive. Where He is, there we will be. As a matter of fact, Paul tells us there we actually are right now because of our union with Him. Let me just read a portion, a very familiar passage in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 9, that reminds us of these things. And really it summarizes everything we've seen to this point. Paul says, "And you were dead in your trespasses and sins, in which you formerly walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, of the spirit that is now working in the sons of disobedience. Among them we too all formerly lived in the lusts of our flesh, indulging the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, even as the rest." Now there's a commentary on what we were like when we came into the world and why the Lord had to subdue us in order for us to enter into that covenant with Him. So here's the subjection. "But God, being rich in mercy, because of His great love with which He loved us, even when we were dead in our transgressions, made us alive together with Christ." There's the union with Christ. There's the Spirit of God connecting us to the life of Jesus and our becoming alive. He says, "By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with Him." So we died with Him, and we were made alive again with Him, and seated us with Him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. I do want you to notice that Paul is including himself in this statement. And he says, we are seated with Christ in heaven. And he said that while he was on earth. So that in the ages to come, he might show the surpassing riches of his grace in kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast. Again, the emphasis of grace, the Mosaic covenant. Do this and you will live. Obey and you'll keep the land. Disobey and I'll take you out of the land. The new covenant, Jesus obeys and he gives you life. He gives you salvation by his gift, not by your works, but by his works, so that no one may boast. We can't boast that we did anything towards our salvation at all. We didn't earn it. We didn't even really, when you understand what the scripture says, we didn't even contribute the faith. The faith itself was a gift from God. But again, the point here is this, that we are in union with Jesus Christ. We're already with him in heaven. We've already made it to the end of the finish line because Jesus is there and we are in union with him. And because we are already in principle in heaven, one day we actually will be with him in heaven. He will make sure that we arrive. The Lord has saved us. The Lord will preserve us. The Lord will provide everything we need to make this journey in order that he might give us to his Son as the reward for his work. It's because of this covenant that he will also make sure that nothing in heaven or earth will ever take us from him. There is no enemy. There is nothing that can separate us from him. Paul writes in Romans 8, verses 38 and 39, "For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord." Notice it's in Christ Jesus. When you are in Christ Jesus, God loves you, and there is nothing that will ever separate you from that love. That's why you and I can know, we've taken hold of Jesus, that we will actually arrive in heaven. And that's also how we can know that the Lord will give to us everything that we need between now and then actually to arrive there. And so when we need, whatever it is we need to remember the covenant. We need to remember the promises that God has made to us on the basis of this covenant. We need to remember why it is the Lord is going to give us these promises, because of Jesus taking our place, because of his promise to the Son to give him the things that he has promised, because we are in union with the Lord Jesus Christ. As a matter of fact, everything we need is in Jesus. If you're outside of Jesus, if you need salvation, salvation is in him. Look to him. If you need assurance that you're going to make it to heaven, that you're ultimately going to be safe, look to Jesus, look to his covenant. It is ironclad on the basis of what the Father has promised to his Son and what his Son has done. If you need daily necessities, look to him. Remember the covenant. And let me also mention, as I mentioned before, as you think about what the Lord calls you to do, as I think about what he calls me to do in a world, again, that's hostile towards him, as I understand myself and my own struggles with my sins, and what the Lord calls me to do, what he calls us all to do, put our sins to death, put on the Lord Jesus Christ, be my ambassadors, be my servants, be my members, serve. Let me serve basically through you. Let me minister through you to bring the gospel to others. As we think about the Great Commission, where are we going to find the resources we need to be able to carry these things out, to become like Jesus, to find the courage we need to reach out to others? We're going to find it in the covenant, because the Lord has also made provision for us in the covenant for that. Not only that we'll make it safely to heaven, but that he will use us while we're here to bring others to heaven as well. That is also a part of this covenant. And so when you need help, look to the Lord. Ask him to remember the covenant and to be gracious to you in all of your all of us to look to him in all of our failings, in all of our weakness, and to ask him for strength, because he has promised to give it to us. He has given to us not a spirit of timidity, but of power, love, and discipline. When the early Christians look to the Lord Jesus, because, I mean, they were in a hostile environment, they just crucified their Lord. And they had been arrested and released, and they knew that they had already been threatened. Don't share any more about Jesus Christ. How did they find the courage to be able to do that? But they looked to what their Lord had promised. They looked to the covenant of God, and they called upon the Lord, and they asked him to remember and give them strength. And the Lord shook that place, and he filled them with his Spirit. And they went out and boldly proclaimed Jesus in the face of a society that just crucified him, and in the face of the leaders of Israel that just threatened them. They believed that what the Lord said he would provide, he would provide, and he was faithful to do it. The Lord is faithful. He will do what he has promised for all the reasons that we've looked at this evening. So we can trust him, and we can act on these things. Well, let's bow for a moment of prayer, and let's ask the Lord to help us trust him and look to him for these blessings.